Hello friends, welcome to my YouTube channel. Today I will take you into the world of Scottish literature because we are going to enjoy the poem composed by Robert Burns, and the title of the poem is My Love is Like Red Red Rose. This poem is very popular around the globe, and this poem is addressed to his beloved, and he is expressing his deep love, deep affection towards his beautiful young woman or his girlfriend, right? So let's begin. And in this poem, basically, you will find that there are so many beautiful imageries, beautiful things that are picturized by the poet. So the title of our poem is A Red Red Rose. It is also very famous as My Love is Like Red Red Rose. That may be the first line of the poem, right? So let's enjoy. But before going into the details of this poem and start explaining all this, let me start explaining about the biographical sketch of this poet or the man who composed this poem, that is Robert Burns. You know, my dear student, Robert Burns was born on the 25th of January 1759, and he died on 21st July 1796. Actually, he is very popular in the galaxy of English literature because he was the first man who had used Scottish language in his writing. Miss, most of the poems are written in Scottish language or the Scottish dialect. He is also popular as the Robbie Burns National Bard or the National Poet of the Scotland or the Plowman Poet. There are so many names, or you know, other names are given to this man. Actually, he is widely regarded as the National Poet of Scotland, right? And if you go and search on the Wikipedia or the Google, you will find or you will get the detailed explanation about this poet. But because we are going to understand the poem, I'm not going to, you know, go into the details of his life, education, you know, his career, his works, and all these things. But I may tell you that he was regarded, or he is very famous as the, you know, pioneer of the romantic movement in Scotland, because there are so many images, there are so many symbols. You know, the interesting concepts from nature he has poured in his poems or in his verses. And, you know, after his death, or after his, you know, when he left the physical world in the 18th century, he became the great source of inspiration to the founders of liberalism and the socialism, and cultural icon in Scotland too. So this is all about the important facts and figures about his life. So let's begin the poem. This poem, My Love is Like Red Red Rose, or A Red Red Rose, is a beautiful poem or a lyric or the romantic poem, or you can also call that love poem that begins or that starts with the poem or with the very worldwide acknowledged simile, that is, oh, my love is like red, red rose. Now see, when we call someone, at that time, we always use the word, oh, brother, come here, likewise. So that O is addressed to his beloved. And the word L-U-V-E, you can see on the screen, that is taken from the Scottish dialect or the Scottish language. And that is why it is a mixture, or it is a chutneyfication of the English and the Scottish dialect in this poem. So, oh, my love is like red, red rose. Now see, the word is red is repeated in the first line. It means that he is very affectionate, or he is very much in love with his beloved. And the symbol of love, the flower rose, is mentioned here, and he compares with the help of that simile, the word like refers that it is there is a comparison between two things or the two objects, his love and the red rose, right? So my love is like red rose that is newly sprung in June. It means that red rose has just bloomed, has just come out or just emerged on the ground in the month of June. So this is very interesting here. He is not talking about the any rose. He has not mentioned the white rose, the yellow rose, or any other color of the rose. But basically or specifically, he is referring or he refers to the red rose as a symbol of love. Okay. So come to the third line. Oh, my love is like the melody. Now another simile is used here. Second time in the first stanza, there are two popular similes or the examples of simile you can find. In the first line, he says, oh, my love is like red rose. And he also continues in the third line and same phrase he has used. Oh, my love is like the melody. Means the melody, the sweet song that is played by the greatest musician, and that is very sweet to our ears. And that concept he catched in this stanza, and he compared with his love also. So this is the second time he compares. Oh, my love is like the melody. So L-U-V-E, love, it means love, modern English, L-O-V-E. Right? And that sweetly played, miss, it is very sweet as sweet, right? It is very sweet to, or it is very melodious to hear, to listen in our life. And it is also very greatly played in tune, he says. Now see, there are metaphors or there is a, you know, sequence of the metaphors and similes are used in this stanza. So I hope, my dear student, you have understood the first stanza. Let me explain once again. Oh, my love is like a red rose that is newly sprung in June. Oh, my love is like the melody that is sweetly played in tune. So here he compares, he imagine, or the imaginary notion is used in this stanza, and he compares. With the help of two popular similes, he compares his beloved, his girlfriend, his beautiful young girlfriend with these objects, with these symbols, with these things like red rose. Okay, come to the second stanza. In the second stanza, he says, so fair art thou. Now, there are so many archaic language or the archaic words are used by the Robert Burns. He says, so fair. Fair means beautiful, very fair, fair and lovely, like that cream. So fair and lovely art thou, he says. Thou means T-H-O-U. It means you. It is the word that has been used from the old English, and T-H-O-U, it means you. So fair, you are very beautiful, you are very gorgeous, pretty, and most beautiful woman in this world. He says, so fair art thou, my bonnie lass. Now, what is the meaning of my bonnie lass? Actually, he is, he has expressed his possession. He has shown his possession towards his wife. He says, ki my beloved is belong to me. She is not the property of other lovers and other people, right? It means he is the only one who loved her very much. And that is why the word has used, that is the word bony. Bony means beautiful. And this word is taken from the Scottish language or the Scottish dialect or the Scotland, the language that's that is very popular in Scotland. So my bonnie lass again, that word refers to a young woman or the beautiful young woman. So it means that my beautiful woman, my beautiful beloved, my beautiful young woman with whom I'm in love. or to whom I love, he says. And in the next line again continues his thoughts, his promises, his conviction, his desire, his depth of love in this stanza. In this second stanza, in the second line, he says, so deep in love am I. It means that he is flowing in the ocean of love. He is enjoying the deep love with his beloved. There is no limit to his love. Likewise, he is trying to show the love that he about his beloved. And in the next line he says, and I will love thee still, my dear. Actually, this is a promise. Actually, he promised to his girlfriend, to his beloved, and says, ki I will love thee. Actually, he, in modern language, he says that, ki I will love you. I will love you, my dear. Thee means, again, the word T-H-E-E, it means you. I will love you, or I love you still, my dear, till the seas gang dry. Means, till that moment when the seas will go dry. Okay, have you heard this concept? Or this is the height of love. This is the highest peak of his exaggeration. And he showed his love about his beloved. So there is a direct comparison between his beloved or his love with these natural objects. And that is why in the very beginning I told you, he was the pioneer, he was the source of inspiration to the founders of romantics, or the romantic poets, and the liberal or social or cultural icon to many people. Okay, Robert Burns was very popular, and after his death, his charisma, his magic, you can see, or impression or influence of his writing, you can see on the contemporary poets. So that is why it is very interesting to learn about this poem. So I hope, my dear student, you understood the second stanza also. Let me repeat once again. So fair art thou, my bonny lass, so deep in love am I. I will love thee still, my dear, till the seas gang dry. It means that in the first stanza, he compares his love with natural symbol, or the symbolic language has been used by the poet. And in the second stanza, he is showing his deep love. And he had made some promises to his beloved that I love you, I will love you until and or till the last minute of my life, or till the doomsday of my life, right? So that is why this, the last line of the second stanza, till the seas gang dry, that says that I will love you still, my last, till the last minute of my life. Okay, come to the third stanza again. So the third stanza begin with the last line of the second stanza. And in this stanza, till the seas gang dry, my dear, and the rocks melt with the sun. Now see another image, another comparison, another interesting things or thing that has been used in the second line. So he says, ki rocks will melt with the heat of sun, or with the rays, or the hot temperature of the sun. Is it possible? No, but still he has shown that kind of exaggeration in this line. And he's repeated the same line that we have seen in the second stanza, that I will love thee still, my dear, while the sands of time shall, sands of life shall run. Can you see on the screen? This is the image of the hourglass. In the ancient time, there were no any watches, or the wrist watches, or the wall watches. So they used to, have this kind of hourglass to see the time, to enjoy the time, or to count the hours, right? So he says, actually, he compares and he showed his promises. I will love you, my dear, till the sands of tile shararam. Again, he takes us into the world of imagination. He is taking us into the world of fancy, you can say, where natural symbols plays very important role. Okay, now come to the last stanza. In the last stanza, we have seen that, let me read, and fare thee well, he says. Actually, this is very interesting. I hope that you may be confused with these words. When you read these words for the first time, you will think that I must take the help of Oxford Dictionary. But no, I will explain you in a very simple language. And fare thee well. Fare means fare thee well. Farewell, goodbye, bid goodbye, good adieu. These are the various words in kids' language. He has used the fare, bid farewell, fare, bid adieu, like these words he has used. So, and fare thee well, only my love. My only love, he says. Now see, the possession or the, it is, he believes that, or from this line, we can understand that he thinks that his beloved is like his property. There is no one can come to this place and start encroaching or start encroachment. Understood? No can says that, or no can declare the rights against his beloved. So that is why he says, and fare thee well. Actually, this is the way they expresses their love. Goodbye and meetings and all these things happens in love. Meetings again and again, that happens in love. So in this meeting, he says, actually he says goodbye to his love, and maybe his beloved is assured that she knew that my beloved, my lover will come back to me. But for surety, to confirm his existence and to his love, he is again repeated that words to make happy his beloved, that he says, and fare thee well, my only love, and fare thee well a while. While means for a short time, for a time being, I'm going somewhere, but I will come again. And he says, I will come again, my love. Now see, this L-U-V-E, the word is repeated many times in this poem. In the first stanza twice, in the second stanza twice, in the third stanza once, and in the last stanza you can find twice. So this place or this word is, you can say, the repetition or repeated many times in this sentence. Now see, the last stanza is all about farewell. It is all about the departing soul. One person is going somewhere from his place. And that is why the same line means the repetition of the same line you can find in the first and the second line of the fourth stanza. So, and fare thee well. And fare thee well. Now see, when the repetition of the same line happens in the poem, there is a refrain. Refrain is a figure of speech that you can connect with this line. For example, if I tell you the poem of Robert Frost, miles to go before I sleep and miles to go before I sleep, these lines are the, or these two lines are repeated in the last stanza of that poem. It means that poet is trying to give stress on his feeling, his deep love, his opinion, his ideas, you can say. And he says in this poem that I fare thee well, fare thee well, and fare thee well, and fare thee well, I will come again, and I will come again, my love, though it were 10,000 miles. Doesn't matter about, or do not care about the distance. Do not care about the 10,000 miles. I will come back. I will return to you. I will reach to you, he says, or he confirms his ideas, his opinion. Okay. So this is how we can understand the poem. And this is how we can learn about this interesting poem. Actually, this poem was produced or come out in the final years of the Robert Bowen's life, when he was working on the on some projects to preserve his traditional Scottish song, or the songs you can say, or the verse, right? And he worked, actually he had shown his two love. One love is for his beloved, and another love for his mother tongue, his Scottish language, his Scottish dialect. Okay, now come to the another important things. Let me talk about the structure of the poem. You have seen that this poem has 16 lines, and these 16 lines are divided into four stanzas. So in these four stanzas, there are four lines. It means four line stanza each, and four into four, 16. Okay, so four line stanza is used. End rhyme scheme is used. Now let me show you what is the meaning of end rhyme stanza. Now you can see in the first stanza, my love is like a red, red rose that is newly sprung in June. Oh, my love is like the melody that is sweetly played in tune. So June tune, BB, and rose melody, it is not rhymed together. So you can give separate word for that. So rose is A, B, C, B. That is the rhyming scheme is used here. Okay. And in this stanza again, or in this poem, the tone of the poet or the tone of the speaker is very romantic. Readers of this poem or the audience of this poem doesn't know, or they are totally unaware about the identity of the speaker, about the age of the speaker. Okay. And that is why you can enjoy that there is a couple, or you can assume that there is a couple who is, or they are in love, they are enjoying the company of each other. And that is why the poet's tone or the tone of the poem, there is a rhythm and there is a, you know, expression of love, deep phenomena of love is found in this poem. Okay, so I hope you got the point. And with the help of various images, with the help of various similes, with the help of various hyperboles and other poetic devices, for example, alliteration, anaphora, imagery, I told you, assonance, paradox, right? Epistrophe. So these are the various figure of speeches the poet has used to increase the intensity of his love. Okay. Actually, because of time, I am not going to explain you about the figure of speeches here. That is hyperbole. Hyperbole, you know, height of love that I told you. That is till I will love thee, still my dear, till the seas gang dry. This is the hyperbolic language. Okay. Then there are some important things. For example, the symbol. You can say in this poem, he has used the symbol rose. And that rose is a symbol of love, not only in India, but all over the world. In the very beginning, he has used the word rose, that is, or that refers to a romantic love. And especially when, you know, especially it is in deep love, or these two people or this couple is in deep love, it is because the color of rose is red. Okay. You can find that there are so many stories, there are so many mythologies or the mythological concepts you will find in the Greek mythologies or the Greek literature or in world literature. But for time being, we can assume with this poem and we can believe that the red rose is a symbol of love. Okay. Now, if I have not explained the speaker in this poem. In this poem, the speaker is anonymous. Anonymous means his identity is not revealed by the poet, and the beloved also not known to anyone. But we can believe that they are very young. That is why they are loving each other and they are expressing this kind of thoughts and expression in this poem. So in this particular poem, the speaker or the lover, you can say, he is describing his love or his expression of love, his romance towards his beloved or to his beloved, who is like a red rose and that is newly sprung in June. Okay, now come to the setting of the poem. You will find that this poem, A Red Rose, is a poem that is set, or the location of the poem you can find in the Scotland, because the Scottish dialect takes us into the world of Scotland, and that is why the bonny lass is not English beautiful woman, is not Indian beautiful woman, but it is she is a Scottish beautiful woman, or the Scottish bonny land, you can say. Okay, so I hope, my dear student, you have enjoyed this, and I hope that you got the gist of the poem. And one thing I missed here, that the themes of the poem. So in this poem, you can now you can understood that the love and the separation, these are the, or this is the most important theme presented in this poem. And Robert Burns is very much careful about his words, his use of imageries, his use of symbols, and the form of the poem, right? Okay. So the second theme is Red Rose is playing a role as a representative of love, right? When we present any white rose to anyone, we always express our feelings about our love to our friend. But here, there is a pure love and there is no any biased ideas, or the biased mind, you can say. They are the true lover, or they are the, you know, they are flowing, as I already said, they are flowing in the oceans of love, okay? In the realm of love, you would say. Okay, so come to the next theme, that is beauty, youth, and aging. So beauty is mentioned in the second stanza. My bonny lass, he says, so fair art thou, likewise, he has used the word youth. Okay, and aging means with the passage of time, they are expressing their love, their ideas, and their attachment, their emotional sentiments about each other, or about his beloved or her lover. Okay, so I think, my dear student, you got the point, and this is for today. And in the next video, I will come with another poem, another explanation, another analysis of any new topic that is prescribed in our syllabus. So if you are new in this channel, you can subscribe my channel and you just subscribe my channel so that you can get the latest notification of the uploaded video. Thank you.